Welcome, everyone. Dick and I are delighted once again to be joined by Peter Larman. And Peter is a retired minister who formerly led Progressive Christians Uniting in Los Angeles and is a current member of the National Council of Elders. Peter serves as a National Council of Elders King and Breaking Silence team. He serves on that team. So, welcome, Peter.
Yeah,
Good to be
so
with you.
Peter, you wrote what we hope is not a fantasy, but is we can dream, can't we? A post-election fantasy, imagining what Kamala Harris, Tim Walz administration would do. What motivated you to dream like that?
Well, there's no penalty for dreaming big, and there's no downside in trying to fully imagine what a truly exhilarating Harris-Walz administration would look like, and steps that they could take kind of right away to signal a new direction in American life. Now, the reason it's very important to underscore that this is a fantasy, I create these fantasy headlines, big bold headlines. Very important to underscore this because, in fact, these projected headlines are about the furthest thing from what is likely to happen, unless there is this enormous pressure from below. That is to say, people really seriously organizing and demanding these changes. But for the benefit of people who haven't actually read the piece, the headlines are Harris and Walz turn against the billionaire class. They completely reject US militarism, the huge military footprint we have around the world, and specifically the armaments and other aid that we give to the state of Israel as it continues to slaughter the gays and people and the Palestinians. Bucking big oil and big ag by taking a major turn in the direction of preserving biodiversity and specifically the health of the oceans. And then finally, putting sharp curbs on the potential of artificial intelligence to destroy us all. So those are just four things I picked, not completely randomly, to say, wouldn't it be nice? I could sing it for you, right?
So I love this piece because what it does is it puts on paper what we all want. And I tell you, Peter, I doubt that Kamala Harris and Tim Walz don't want this as well. I doubt they
Okay.
don't want this. I bet you they do want this as individuals. Personally, they'll never come out and say that, but they have no reason to be cheerleaders for the billionaires club, except or but for the poor way our campaigns are funded in the United States. You know, they puts them in a really bad position to be beholden to them. So I'm leading up and taking a long way to lead up to a question about people who think that if we just pick just the right person, that these problems will go away. When in my mind, I think they're systemic problems. And I have a hard time believing that there is a politician, as much as they will want the same thing, there's no politician out there that could claim this.
There you go. I'm thinking of that movie. Thinking of fantasies. Come on, help me with this. Was it Warren Beatty? Bulwer, something
Oh
like that. Do you
yeah.
remember that?
Bulwark.
I love that movie.
Yeah,
I love that movie so
Barry.
much because that
He loved
because
it.
he just went right to the people, spoke. It was like, I'm just gonna tell you, I'm gonna say what's on your mind. He was like, a Trump for the people, kind of. You know what I mean? For the actual people
Yes.
and for their interests. You're right. I mean, this is not to in any way to criticize the idealism of Vice President Harris or Governor Walz at all. I think if they were cut loose from this system, as you say, it's systemic. But the system we have is a pay-for-play system. There's no question about that. And what is this? This federal election is already up to $12 billion, something like that. I mean, $12 billion, if you put it all, if you stacked it all up, it would be a big pile of money.
Well, so my feeling is Kamala Harris is not as tied into the establishment as you might think. Even though she's been an elected official for a long time, she was essentially sidelined during the Biden administration and given unpleasant assignments and kind of downgraded by the mainstream media. And I think that if she can find any kind of support in Congress, she will push for some of the things that you outlined. I think, too, that we know there's going to be an outburst of outrage or whatever from the MAGA world, either way, whether Trump wins or Harris wins. But I think if Harris wins, there's going to be a huge upsurge of enthusiasm on the left, as we saw when she was named to replace Biden. And I think she could, over time, ride that to make some changes. I also think that she's not as tied into the albatross around her neck, which is Gaza. I think she and a lot of people in Washington would like to find a solution. I think Biden is a no fundamental change. He was stuck in a position that he would not move from. I don't think she's stuck in quite the same position.
I agree with you. I heard a report earlier today from a person named Charlie Sennett, who used to be a newspaper person who runs this Ground Truth thing. He was reporting from Dearborn, Michigan, and he was saying that the vice president will be in Michigan tonight, on the day we're recording this, which I believe is the 28th. He'll be there. She'll be there tonight. And he said, and this is very unusual for Charlie Sennett, he said she must connect with the Arab American vote in Michigan. She must connect, because right now she doesn't have them, and Michigan is razor thin, and it could in fact be that 20,000 votes in Michigan decide this election. So I'm hoping, I'm praying that she finds the words tonight to say, really say, this is unacceptable, I will stop this. It's going to be hard, but if she could, it's going to help her immensely.
Well, if she doesn't
say it, maybe it's too late. Maybe it's too late.
It might be too late, but if she doesn't find those words to at least hint at putting an end to the travesty that's going on in Gaza, if she doesn't do that, I'll be even more convinced that she really doesn't have the power to do it.
But if she can't take a strong stand someplace, then what's the point of getting enthused about it?
Well, it's not just, that's not just true about Kamala Harris. That's true about all politicians at this point in our history. Corporatists have taken over, and we've got to change the way that campaigns are funded.
Right.
I mean, you know, from Wade's little campaign, it's impossible. It's impossible to run a campaign without deep pockets supporting you. And those deep pockets don't do it for nothing.
Well, you suppose, and this really isn't as far off topic as it may seem, I'm getting, I don't know, 25 to 30 texts a day from, they come from different phone numbers, but they're all kind of ActBlue related. Let's say, you know, we've asked you 7 times already today, you know, do you support Kamala Harris or not? I mean, gosh only knows. I mean, it's insulting to our intelligence, because people who follow the news know that at the moment, the Harris campaign does not have a finance deficit, number one. But also, number two, that level of sort of assault every time you pick up your phone is for some people, it's going to turn them off. For some people, it might even, God forbid, keep them from voting.
Yeah,
it's not going to produce any money. I don't understand it.
Well, they are the professionals. And so I think that people like you, Peter, and me and Dick, we're not the average. You know, we're the people who have our noses buried in this stuff. We publish, you write, publish. We're in this every single day. But the average person, not so much. And maybe this is their only contact with news. It's through their phones or being bugged by text messages.
Well, I must say that
it must be effective or they wouldn't do it. And yeah. I think it's sort of like you know, hackers, you know, they, if they get one in a thousand, they've made their daily, you know, they've made their daily nut.
That's right.
But,
remember,
but it's really offensive to me. It drives me nuts.
It has to be counterproductive. And I don't think they really have the data to support it. I know they've taken my phone away from me and mostly taken my email away from me. I don't answer my phone unless a person's name pops up because I just don't want to deal with it. And my text messages, it's useless at this point. I'm thinking of switching my number or something.
No, I don't take Dick's position. I believe that we're not representative of the masses. I think that what you said, Peter, is it must be working or they wouldn't keep doing it. It's sort of like those email messages that you would get from Nigeria or the phone calls. One time my father was rushing off because he had gotten a message that I was in Nigeria and had been kidnapped and they needed $1,000. And he was on his way to send the money to him.
But that's it. It's not one in a thousand. One in a million has to work, and they make their nut.
So who knows? Maybe they send out 50 million of them.
They probably do.
And they get $2,000 from 50 million people. It made it worth it.
Well, before we close today, I want to go back to the point that you made that really actually thank you, Sharon and Dick. You kind of made my day by saying, let's be clear about this. It's not about the personal orientation of these leaders or that they can't see that things are fundamentally broken. It's they're operating in a broken system. Right. Now, if they get into office, it doesn't mean they're liberated, which goes back to my point about we, the people of the United States of America, are the ones who have to say continuously, congratulations, thank you, I'm relieved, now let's get down to work on this stuff, right? Let's get down to work on this stuff. I still believe that organized people can outflank organized money. I still believe that. But we need to demonstrate that. And the chronic problem of the liberal establishment in the United States is we suffer from election derangement syndrome. So we think if our folks get over the finish line November 5th, okay, we can relax, right? We can't relax.
So the theory was back when Bernie Sanders was running several times that he would get, was it $27 donation?
Yeah.
And that's all he would take. And that propelled a nearly successful campaign. And Kamala was talking about getting small donations too. Well, the trick then is to ride those rather than go to the Jeff Bezos and the cohorts and the Elon Musk to call a tune. I mean, if you can build a campaign and keep the people interested, but then you have to propose things that the people want to see. I mean, 70 or 80% of America wants Medicare for all. Well, who's championing that? Not even Bernie Sanders anymore. Because
everybody wants progressive taxes. Everybody wants progressive taxes, right. Except, of course, the billionaires.
Right. Right. So, I mean, so it, in theory, at least, and even in practice, because at least the Obama, Bernie Sanders and Kamala Harris campaigns have generated huge amounts of small donations from millions of people. If they can tag that in and the technology is there and ride that rather than running off to billionaires all the time, then we would be a step ahead on having better elections.
Well, I think that we can see what they're doing. And what they're doing is they're running off to billionaires. And why? Because it's more effective. I mean, it's easier to get $1 billion from four or five people than it is to get $1 billion from 150 million people. Because you and I both know we've done door knocking. We've done phone calls, phone banking. People in this United States are not engaged. And that is always the missing link. This is a democracy. It requires people to be involved, and they're not involved. And I can understand why they're not, but they don't seem to be able to connect the dots that you are never going to get what you want until you get in there and make it happen.
But let's not pat ourselves too hard on the back. We door knocked for 2.5 hours. We phone banked for 45 minutes.
Two and a half hours more than probably 300 million people
we
in this country.
Yes, we can check that box, but that's not, you know, it's not like we're foot soldiers campaign.
So now we're having an argument.
That's what I always hope for in one of these exchanges. I'm always hoping the two of you will go at it. Listen, what we're really talking about here is a vicious cycle. So as long as it's easier, and I agree with you, Sharon, easier to talk to five billionaires, right, at a private party someplace than to talk to, you know, 5,000, householders. As long as that's easier, the 5,000 householders are not stupid. They're like, okay, I get this. It's not about me. It's just not about me. I'm here. They want my vote, but they really take me for granted. I like what you said, Dick, about the Sanders campaign. It almost seems as though the core lesson of the Sanders campaign, if you run hard against the corporate class, you can win, has been kind of lost. That's clearly not something that particularly appeals right now to the Democratic Party.
Yeah.
So Michelle Obama recently gave one of the most powerful speeches I've heard in a long time. And she spoke to millions of people, and she didn't have to talk to four billionaires. She talked to millions of people with that speech. And if you, I mean, I find that persuasive.
Not me, she started off by saying that she hates politics.
Yeah.
And she didn't explain why she hates politics. She talked to people that also hate politics, and they're going to show up as often as she's shown up. We have got to turn this ship around by getting people engaged in politics and not just voting.
But she's afraid of politics, I think, in large measure, because
she's
been the subject of all kinds of death threats.
No, she hated politics even before Barack Obama ran for the presidency.
Okay.
Okay.
Right, it was Sharon. That's our lesson for today.
But I did want to say, I downplayed our noble efforts on door knocking, but we had a most wonderful rally at home, meet and greet with four politicians, including George Gascon.
And Frankie Carrillo, who is running for California State Assembly, Assembly District 52, Erica Wiley, who is running for Los Angeles County Superior Court Judge, George Turner, who's also running for Los Angeles County Superior Court Judge, and David Kim, who's running for Congress. He wasn't here, but we endorse him and had lots of his yard signs. And then, of course, George Gascon, who is running for Los Angeles County District Attorney. And more people need to just have little gatherings at their homes.
Right.
Yep.
It was
Go ahead. Here in little Rhode Island, my friends and I are already planning, regardless of how the election turns, the middle of January, just before the inauguration, we're going to get together and talk about where do we go from here. And we'll try to bring in as many, regular people as possible to be part of this. Because again, and my whole point about this this little article is that November 5th is not the end. It's the beginning, if we're ever going to break this stranglehold of big money and power over our lives.
That's right. Well, that's a perfect note to close on, Peter. We thank you so much for being so committed to getting the word out, to educating the populace, and for doing what you do. We really appreciate it.
Hey, listen, I'm not a preacher for nothing. I know how to get to the amen.
Thank you, Peter.
Thank you.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for sticking around. If you like the LA Progressive content and the discussions we have here, please consider clicking the subscribe button below and also give us a thumbs up. That helps to grow our audience by feeding the algorithm, which helps to get this content in front of more eyes. Thanks for stopping by. We really appreciate your support.